1988. Since then and before, a number of unarmed black men were killed by police. At this time, I want to do a brief moment of silence in the honor of all those victims. Thank you. We are dismayed that after fighting for human rights in Canada for 46 years, I am here at this point to try to debate the constitutional rights of citizens of Canada, which are enshrined in the Charter of Rights and Freedom. In free and democratic society, police have a bound duty to protect society. But there are rules governing how they do that. It is not by committing other crimes or infringing on people's rights. Police have the right under the Constitution to stop people when they have reasonable and probable grounds to believe that they have knowledge or been involved in the commission of an offense, or is planning to commit an offense. The issue of carding, regardless of what people think, does not deal with that right of the police to investigate crimes and to prevent crimes. What we are dealing with is the arbitrary stopping, questioning, and collecting of data on people, putting it in a database, and then they are forever known by the police. This is what we fought against in South Africa, the past laws that kept blacks in the bantu stands, and for them to leave their bantu stand, they needed a pass. And by the way, the bantu stands were modeled after the Canadian Indian Reserve. What we're saying here then, I have a full presentation which I will be passing on to the ministry and to the media, which addresses a number of the issues. It lists a number of the people that were summarily executed by the police and a number of other cases, as well as some other results of the creation of Black Action Defense Committee. Black Action Defense Committee has marched in Toronto against police brutality, and we are fighting at the forefront to end this nefarious practice of racial profiling, anti-black racism, racial profiling, and summarily stopping, whether you call it carding, street checks, or whatever it is. We want our people to be able to walk with dignity and pride, and to feel that they are served and protected by the police, regardless of their color or the color of their chief. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I have to surrender, but I want to tell you this, that Black Action Defense Committee still has the DNA of protest in our veins. And we still have our banner. But my message to the Attorney General of Ontario, the Chief Law Officer of Ontario, is that if the government comes up with a regulation, a policy, or legislation that impinges on individuals' charter rights, we will be taking it straight to Geneva, to the United Nations Commission on Human Rights, because they have the premier and the Attorney General have the carriage of justice to ensure that the justice is maintained and carried out in Ontario, and we are going to hold their feet to the fire on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Kingsley, did you want to leave me with a copy of that?
Where are you?
I'm right there. Thank you. Okay, so we'll add this to what comes out of tonight. Okay, so just a reminder that we are running two microphones tonight, so you can line up on either side in an effort to get to you faster. Dave, your microphone, and of course, your sir.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, to all the Muslims, I say Assalamu Alaikum. To the non-faith believers, I say good evening. To the Christians, I say greeting in the name of Jesus. And to the Jews, Shalom. I would like to, I am a Reverend Richard Mitchell. I'm an individual who have a diverse background, you may say. In 2003, I was graduated as with my theology. I was ordained as a pastor in 2002. In 2005, I graduated from Sheridan College with a diploma in community work, outreach, and development. And in 2008, I graduated from Vancouver College of Counseling with a diploma professional.
Folks, if I can get everybody else to please give this gentleman the respect of listening to him speak the way that you offer Kingsley respect and the way we want to offer you respect, please.
As I was saying, in 2008, I graduated from Vancouver College of Counseling Training with a diploma of a professional counselor, whereby I generalize in sexual abuse, substance abuse, and trauma in general. Dating back to 2003, I was also on the board, the backseat board, Black Action Defense Committee, with a number of different persons. I've served also on the circle of support for persons who have been convicted for sexual assault. I've also been in the Canadian military to some extent. I'm also trained by RCMP in community policing. So again, I have a diverse background.
Make the point.
The point is tonight, we are here to address the issue in which we call carding. So oftentimes we will look at the comments on the board through the media and through the provincial government now, Ms. Wynn, who is basically saying that they ought to somewhat regulate carding. I believe carding, it shouldn't be a question about regulating carding. How can you regulate something that's as traumatizing to me, certain segment of the community, especially I'm an advocacy as well, and for Black empowerment. I teach and I preach Black theology. And in that essence, I have seen and I've heard how so many from the Black community who has been preempted in pursuing decent living due to the fact that they have been carded and now become known to the police. And one officer told me back in 1986, this Caucasian officer that was working at 51 Division, his mandate is to criminalize as many Black persons possible. And it's so unfortunate that I do not have the name but it's easy to get his name. And this tells me that it's not only that police officer's mandate, it told me that it was implementation out of 51, or maybe the headquarters as well, or through higher government to criminalize black person, to keep them from advancing in a way that will be beneficial to their homes, to the community, and society at large. So, and the government in 2009 has implemented the Poverty Reduction Act, which is to say to eliminate poverty throughout the province of Ontario. However, due to the fact that Carden has been sometimes purposely implemented on young black males, and then you have lawyers who would encourage them to plead guilty to something that they have not really committed, and it again prevents them from advancing in this society as they ought to. So the final, in closing, I would say the provincial government needs to look again on the Poverty Reduction Act, seeing that these individuals are unable, being that they are already from low-income communities and housing, are unable to find adequate and effective defense to clear them from this unjust arrest or allegations. And one of the things is the transcripts cost a tremendous amount of money to obtain from the court. And the government needs to see this and look at it, that this the fees for these transcripts should be exempt for those who are living in poor income housing.
Thank you very much. Okay. So I just want to reiterate a couple of things here. We have 20 minutes left on formally until we close 8 o'clock. And I know that people want to be heard, but what we're going to really need is for people to tighten their thoughts up a whole bunch more and keep it really to, you know, under 2 minutes of speaking. Because I want to make sure that we do hear from you, as many of you as we can. So, Erica, your mic. And if you can get your thoughts. If we can get your thoughts as clearly and concisely pass it on to the next person also.
Okay, so there is a maximum law that says in law all definitions are dangerous. So the reason why carding is inherently fraudulent is because can any of you say that you've been given proper notice on what exactly a person is? And I would say this because when I looked at Desmond's article and he provided an example of what a contact card is, says person's name, person's comments, person's identifications, person's address. Like seriously, do any of you know what the definition of person is they're using? Because that's how you guys are getting bound up. There's a maximum law that the application is the life of a rule. The definition of person in the criminal code is Her Majesty in an organization. Does Desmond Cole look like Her Majesty in an organization? No. In the Legislation Act, the definition of a person is a corporation. Does he look like a corporation, anybody? No. In the City of Toronto Act, the definition of a municipality is a municipality. Again, he does not look like a municipality. So we cannot leave here tonight until we ask the Solicitor General McVie or Chief Saunders or whoever else has the knowledge of what exactly the definition of a person is. What's the definition of a person? And when you get stopped for carding, Deputy Chief Slowly has been good enough to basically imply to me on Twitter that all you guys have to do in the future, and you can correct me if I'm mistaken, anything, all you have to do is take peace officer. You know, I love you guys, but I do not consent. The Supreme Court of Canada, in the reference regarding the secession of Quebec, said it was still by consent of the government. Why on earth would any of you ever feel the need that you have to answer the question of one of your servants? Well, ask Deputy Chief Slowly if he's here. He's retweeted and favored those two tweets. That all you gotta do is say, I do not consent, and walk away.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so we'll move back over now to Dave's microphone. Floor is yours.
Hi, I'm Sharon Gresh from the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists. I am grateful that
have so many great people come out from our community to discuss this issue. But as far as I'm concerned, just looking at the questions, they've already basically told me that they're going to do it anyway, regardless of what we decide today. It's not a true open forum, because if it was a true open forum, we would be deciding the questions to ask.
Very good.
Thank you very much. Woo!
Hey, hi, Susan Gapka. Ladies and gentlemen, and everyone else, how are you doing?
Yeah, but let's make her go first.
Okay, so what we want you to do is stand in the center so we can be behind you in the center.
Stop rocking the boat now.
I'd like to move to you. Okay, very good.
I want to shine a light on a disadvantaged community. Trans people,
so young lady is going to speak up. We want to be behind her for sure. She's going to go before. So if we can come, they're not paying attention right now because they're on the left. So if we can come to the center to be behind this young lady, okay?
No, I want to hear what you have to say.
So, hon, you're going to speak, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Why not? That would be differential treatment.
Okay. Come on up. Come on up. While they're distracted. Come on up.
Sorry, I'm going to stop.
Everybody, we're here. Excuse me, friend.
Under the Ontario Human Rights Code, we have a series of protected enumerated grounds listed. And trans people are protected under gender identity and gender expression.
You can hold the mic, but if you just walk up to where we are. Just right here. Thank you.
We have significant interactions with authorities. We are underhoused and underemployed at a significant rate. Our suicidality rate is almost 50% of the population and has been attempted by almost 80% in the limited reporting that we have. Mental health and addictions are serious outcomes of trying to deal with who we are. And so we will end up on a street, on a public street, and interact with the police. So I just want to say as an individual tonight.
Oh yeah, that's exactly what we're going to do. Yeah, and we're all going to stand with her.
Okay.
How
far
are you moving? Just right here.
That it is wrong and probably unconstitutional to stop people based on how they appear on the street. So I stand in solidarity.
Thank you.
Sorry.
You need to speak shortly, okay?
The longer you heckle, the longer I stay here. You will not bully me. You will not intimidate me. And you can sit down.
So we want the gentleman is going to walk over. So we should just stand there now.
You did not speak out when the previous people went on and on. So please let me finish without being distracted.
But you'll be okay. They'll be okay with that. Because we're going to be over here.
So this is a consultation on street checks. If there is any evidence in this room tonight about differential treatment, then the evidence is before you. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So before we continue tonight, I just want to point out that because we have so many people we do want to hear from tonight, if it is your intention to come up a second time, we are not going to hear from people a second time until we have had an opportunity to hear from everybody who wants to be heard a first time. And once again, please keep your comments as tight and as clear as they can be so that we can make sure that we are able to hear from everybody in the next 15 minutes or so. Dave, you're next.
Whether or not we deserve a fundamental human right here.
research, and we already see how this is very much a biased process. If you read these sticky notes here, then you'll learn nothing new. We've been telling you to end this practice already. But why I'm so deeply troubled and so deeply offended by this is because we've spent such a long time speaking in these small groups, but we've already been talking, we've already been networking, we've already been organizing. We need to talk to you, Mark Saunders. I'm speaking to you. I'm speaking to the officials and the representatives and the police in this room. We don't want to sit around a table and write on sticky notes anymore, because you're not going to leave community. You don't listen to these sticky notes because you don't listen to us when we shut down highways. You don't listen to us when we are beaten and harassed. You don't even listen to us when we're when we die. So this is not an effective process here. And I, just to illustrate this, I can't even hold my own microphone to talk about the kind of inspiration that I'm facing in this room. So now, I turn to the people in this room, all of you in this room, community members, community organizers, and I want to take a second to acknowledge the groups that didn't even come today because they recognize how ineffective this process is. They recognize what a farce this process is. We don't need to be trying to negotiate our rights with the police because they are not listening to you. You just look at the way this is structured, you can tell they're not listening to you. We need to be networking and talking and organizing with each other, because at the end of the day, that seems to be all we've got here. These sticky notes are ineffective, these sessions are ineffective, and you need to hear us, you'll hear us as an organization. Thank you.
These are the people that made the roads in which we are here today to discuss, according to the Toronto Star investigation, between 2008 and November 2013, police filed out of 2.1 million contact cards involving 1.2 million individuals. The vast majority of the contact card interaction involved no arrests or charges. If investigation or solving crime and not carrying out street harassment and racial profiling was the aim of the police, they are already in possession of reasonable suspicion as an investigative tool. Reasonable suspicion empowers cops to stop, question, and detain people in Canada if they believe there is a reasonable possibility rather than a possibility of crime by the persons in question. My point here today, under the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, the Native Canadian is having the same issues that we're having. Let's not go back to history where the poachers sent us back as slaves back to America because we were not free. This is another form of poaching of us people of color. Let us not get it twisted. Let's look at the facts. And the facts are well stated by this Toronto Star investigation.
Thank you very much. Dave, who is the next person in line here?
Stay here. He'll come over. Don't worry. He's mobile. Good. Hi. Megan Whitfield, Coalition of Black Trade Unions. This whole process, it's nice to say we're here consulting. But it's kind of sad because, just like the sister said before, the people that need to be in this room, it seems like the minds are already made up. To me, my fundamental rights as a woman, a black woman, I may not get stopped as much, but I see what Cardin has done to my sons. I'm a mother of three young boys, and I was at the table and somebody says, well, we need to educate your youth on their rights. By staying silent, we know what happens afterwards, the escalation. We should not have a process where we're asked, where the government's asking us what's okay. The whole process is wrong. It's against their rights and freedoms, and there's no justification for it, right? What I see this consultation doing is looking for an excuse to continue on. Because since Cardin is so tough and halted, all I'm hearing now is Toronto is becoming the sum of the guns again. What's been happening? We also have to address the issues. A lot of the young black males have precarious jobs. When my son is going home at 2 o'clock in the night, and he has to walk home and he's being stopped and say, where are you? If he can't justify, how many times is he going to get stopped before he's pushed again, right? When we ask about accountability, there's no accountability because you're carding us with the checks and balances. But what are the checks and balances that we're asking for the receipts of the police officers and the lawmakers in the park to say, is this exactly a practice? Is it racism? What is being defined? There's no checks and balances. It goes both ways. I hear community policing, and I think there is no community policing. Because the community policing would know exactly what's going on within my community. They wouldn't have to card those young brothers that are walking in the community that are so-called suspects. Because community policing, each one knows one, teaches one. Thank you.
Can you give advance notice? Because some of you may be looking at the time, and I know that we're meant to end at 8 o'clock. What I will do at 8 o'clock is take about a 90-second pause to let those of you who need to leave the room do so without worrying about interrupting any speakers. So we will do that at 8 o'clock, and then we'll pick up again for about another 15 minutes, and we'll see how it goes from there. Erica, you're on mic.
I'm happy that this consultation is happening, but sad that Toronto was not originally even on the list of cities to be consulted when this is where this conversation about carding really began. So, you know, I guess you guys got there eventually, but I don't know how you could have made that oversight to begin with. I want to say just a few things, if I can, briefly about this process and about the way that you guys are framing it, so that you understand why, although it's been expressed very clearly already, why people are so upset with the way that this is being framed. So first of all, this preamble in your online document, it says, I'm going to read it, street checks done properly are a necessary and valuable tool for police in their efforts to help communities remain safe and secure. A necessary and valuable tool. That sounds really nice. Where is the data? Where is the evidence that this is a necessary tool? You cannot, see when you do that as the province of Ontario, when we call you and say we need help with this practice is hurting us. And then you frame the discussion by saying, but it's a valuable practice. Where is your evidence? I asked the chief of police who's over there, I've been waiting for the opportunity to ask in public, and we will keep asking all of you media here, you guys take this note down and you ask him. Where is the data?
Yeah.
When you stop someone, how often does it lead to an arrest? How often does it lead to a charge? How often is a weapon found? How often are drugs found? Because if 95 or 98 or 99% of the time you find nothing, the practice is illegitimate and has to stop.
Thank you.
Another problem I have with this document, you guys say, what is a street check? And you provide some possible definitions. For example, if a police officer, I'm reading from the document now, for example, if a police officer comes across an individual apparently loitering late at night in an area that has been experiencing an increased number of break-ins, the officer should be able to ask that individual what they are doing there and ask for their name and other information to identify them. By putting this in your document, you're telling us you don't understand what the hell we are saying as community. You know how many times I've been told that this exact situation applies to me, that for standing, for existing in my own community. Because you see, when you say it like this, you're opening it up to the definitions and prejudices of the officer. The officer sees me and says, as you guys put it here, this terrifying wording that you use, that something is out of the ordinary, something seems out of the ordinary. Yeah, I've been told that a lot. That's not my problem, that's the police's problem because they don't know how to do their job without harassing a young black person. So this out of the ordinary, giving the police a reason to stop and document something, how could you guys frame this like this? That's the exact kind of situation that we are trying to stop. So no, unless I am committing a crime, you have suspicion to believe I'm about to commit a crime, or I am the subject of an investigation, that's when something should be out of the ordinary. Not when an officer wants to play out his prejudices or her prejudices.
Amen.
I'm going to wrap up. I don't want to leave you alone.
Some of these questions are patently ridiculous. Should there be limitations on the information that the police can take? What do you think? Why are you even asking that question? Why don't you already know the answer?
It's a farce.
When you ask about young people and should there be rules around young people, we saw today, or maybe it was yesterday, that the Hamilton police have been using the exact same sheet for carding as Toronto police, and there is a section on the carding sheet for young people and their information about whether their parents are married or divorced, about whether or not they're in school. This is what you've been empowering the police to do, and then you ask us if there should be rules about youth? Why don't you know that that's wrong? Why don't you know? I'll just finish by saying this. Minister Nakby said that there is zero accountability, or sorry, that there is zero tolerance for racism. Yeah, I'll get to the accountability part. But Minister Nakby said that there is zero tolerance. If there is zero tolerance, why have no police been punished for discriminating against us? You cannot just say that you don't tolerate something, but then provide zero, what there is zero consequences. You say zero tolerance, there is zero consequences. And there need to start being consequences for police officers who engage in this random and arbitrary behavior. So when you make your draft of this new regulation, I hope that if you believe, as you say, that this is a voluntary process, I hope that you will tell officers that they have to tell us it's a voluntary process. Because I don't sign up for anything unless someone tells me it's voluntary, okay? They have to inform us that it is a voluntary process and that we are free to go. Otherwise, you have not been incarnated. They have to tell us that I'm going to give you a receipt just like I would for a traffic ticket, so that if you don't like the way that I interacted with you, you have a way of documenting it and following up on it. If you don't do that, you haven't been incarnated. You have to take away the database that the police have already collected from them. Some people don't want to destroy it fully. I understand that, because maybe in 100 years, after everybody in this room is gone, you can release all the names that you collected and make a monument to the stupidity and racism that still exists in society. But you have to take it away from the police for the meantime. If you don't want to destroy it, at least don't let them keep having access to it to re-stigmatize me walking down the street, because it should never be collected in the meantime. And finally, the only reason that the police should be stopping us in this way, call it police stops, don't call it street checks. They are police stops, call it what it is. And the only time that they should stop us is, like I said, if we are engaged in criminal activity, if we're expected to be about to engage in it, or if we're the subject of an investigation. The police have so many tools already, warrants, investigative detention. They can have informal conversations. They can do all of that stuff. They do not need this practice. And we will be watching what your regulation says to ensure that when you say you want to end this practice, you actually take the steps necessary to do it.
Thank you.
She goes,
gone in.
Thank you, Sean.
Thank you.
Yes, good night, everyone. I just gonna say I respect your point of view and your approach, but black people are not only pretty when they're killing us. It's not pretty. It's a dirty war. It's terrorism against the black community. We can't smile and we can't approach.